Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Good morning. So, the purpose of this my short talk is to try to contribute to the discussion of this workshop by considering some problem about heat transport. So, basically, my lecture will be very much connected to the to the introduction of Stefano Lepri. Actually, it is nice he gave this introduction so that I will not have to do. To introduce some of the things he already said. So my lecture in some sense will be, can be a bit shorter. So as it was a remark, it is believed that heat conduction obeys Fourier law, even though there is no rigorous mathematical derivation of this law from dynamical, macroscopic and dynamical equations of motion. There is a lot of theoretical work, a lot of numerical simulation, and all this seems to point in the direction that Fourier law is strongly connected to deterministic chaotic behavior of the corresponding dynamical system. So, so I will discuss some problem about conductivity and also about rectification of the heat flux. So this idea that Fourier law is connected to the chaos was our starting conjecture many years ago when we first approach this problem to try to derive Fourier law from dynamical equation of motion. So for this we took a very simple system, actually the simplest possible system, non-trivial. So we took a one-dimensional system of particle, very simple in the sense that even particles are harmonic oscillator connected to some fixed position, and hot particles are just free particles and they collide elastically. And so this model is very simple, is easy to integrate numerically, and moreover, it has the property that if some parameter is less than something, less than one, there is a transition to complete chaos in the system, exponential instability, and so on. And so it is a bit of the chaotic property. So if you look at this system, then you can show that this obeys Fourier law. Yeah. Basically, the way to do, as was mentioned by Stefano, is to do, for example, non-stationary, non-equilibrium simulation. So what you do, you take your system, you put in contact with thermal bath to the left and to the right. So when the particle arrive here, numerically is reflected back with some velocity which is given by a Maxwellian distribution of temper of T. So you do the same for the other. Then you wait until the system reaches stationary state. Then you can compute the internal temperature as average velocity square. You can compute the energy exchange with the bath by this quantity to the left and to the right. You wait until it reaches stationary state, and then you have internal gradient, you have the current, and you can see whether Fourier law is valid or not, and then you can show that at least in this case, for this chaotic system, Fourier law is valid. This is about classical mechanics. I will not speak about quantum mechanics, but there is almost an analogous situation. Also in quantum mechanics, you can see that when there is what is defined as quantum chaos also is connected to the possibility to have Fourier law. But this is not the subject I want to speak. So chaos is connected. So it is quite expected that if you break this property, for example, if you have some conserved quantity, for example, if you have a completely integrable system in which you have n constant of the motion for n degrees of freedom, then you expect ballistic behavior. But actually, even if you have only one conserved quantity, for example, like was mentioned by, you have momentum conservation, it was mentioned by Stefano, then already it is known since 1970 that the transport is not diffusive and is characterized by divergent transport coefficients. So the conductivity increase with the sample size. So maybe Stefano will enter this, but let's just be briefly mention that for an deconserving system, the conductivity will depend on the system size with some power. And probably we'll discuss, but there is no general consensus on the numerical value. And different models predict different coefficients. And also from numerical point of view, which I'm going to discuss, there is also not agreement. For example, in a recent paper, it has been found that looking at this one-dimensional system, conserving momentum conserving, with Lennard Jones or Morse or Coulomb potential, in some sense quite general potential. Yeah? Then it's found that there is Fourier law, which is quite strange, it's somehow in contradiction with the theoretical result and so on. So I would like to just, as a first part, just to discuss a little bit of this because, well, theoretical results are not rigorous, but even numerical results, maybe they present some more problem. One should be very careful. And this one point I want to discuss is just this. So as a model, we take one already meshed by Stefano, namely a sequence of particles, hard particles, so a particle that move freely and they collide elastically. It is necessary to they have different mass. We take a diatomic lattice because if they have the same mass, then the system is trivially integrable. And in this case, you can compute the conductivities given by this expression, where TL and T right are the temperature of the bath, left and right. So for the integral case, it's trivial, and the motion is heat is ballistic. But when the mass become different, when the system is isolated, it can be shown that this system is ergodic and mixing. Well, it's not exponentially unstable, but it is not necessary. So it is ergodic and mixing system. So you expect, in some sense, to a Fourier law. But here there is this momentum conserving quantity, so you expect something different. Okay, so if you look at this model in detail, this is the result. So I want to discuss a little bit this result of numerical simulation. These are numerical simulations with non-equilibrium. So if you take mass equal one, it is equal mass case, then you see the conductivity increase linearly with n as expected, and it's just this theoretical expression. So this is just a confirmation that your numerical scheme is correct, you just obtain what you expect, okay? But as you change a little bit the masses, for example, instead of one, you take another value. So for some time, for some length n, the system obviously tries to follow the interval case, and then it deviates, and it appears to tend to a constant. So it appears, in this case, that you get Fourier law, which somehow is not expected, according to the theoretical consideration. Then if you increase the mass, again, you get Fourier law. So you wonder, well, what to do, for example, in this case, because it seems you get Fourier law, but some problem. So you look for other confirmation. You cannot increase the number of particles. You arrive already 10 to the 5. So this is not the way to go. So you look for other confirmation. For example, you may try to compute the internal temperature gradient. So if you assume that there is Fourier law, you can compute internal temperature gradient, you get this expression. Then you can compare this expression with the numerical result. And you see, so this expression is this dotted line. And as you see, as you increase the number of particles, you just converge almost perfectly to this theoretical expression you expect compatible with Fourier law. Okay, but then again, you want to be sure that indeed you get Fourier law. So you look for other computation, namely you can use try to compute conductivity using Green Cube formula. Linear response theory, as was already mentioned by Stefano, so I will not enter here. So, but basically what you do, you compute the conductivity as integrable to the correlation function of the heat current, as was explained before. So you take the system without the bath, you remove the bath, you take periodic boundary condition, you compute correlation function, current correlation function, you compute conductivity in this way. And this is the result. And this is the result. Compare the two conductivity, one with non-equilibrium and one with equilibrium, as a function of the length of the system. And you see, as you increase the length, they converge to the same value. So we have at least three. What I plot here, this horizontal line, are just the result of Green Cubo computation. And they coincide with non-equilibrium computation. So all this seems to indicate that you get Fourier law. But then this is not really the case because if you, this is the same picture as before, in which I had other line, I had other mass ratio. So before I only show a line here, but now if I increase the mass of the other particle from 1 to 3, you see that here it goes a tendency to the increase the expected power 1/3. So coefficient thermal conductivity diverges according to this power, and see, and then you see you have this situation, which tells you that if you would increase the length of the system, which we cannot, most likely we will go to the to this behavior. So our conclusion is that this behavior will be present for all value of the masses, even though we cannot exclude the possibility that there is a kind of phase transition here between one behavior to the Fourier law, but this we will consider very strange. So our idea is that what will happen is there is this 1/3 divergence of conductivity. This is for the this hard point gas model, but we have done the same, for example, for another model which already Stefano mentioned, which is a nonlinear model, which is one of the few models. I mean, there are 4 or 5 models which are integrable with nonlinear interaction. One of these, the most famous probably, is the total lattice, which is a model of particle which is nonlinear potential, which is integrable, in the sense that with n particles, there's n constant of the motion. Well, it is integrable if they consider equal mass case, if they have equal mass. But if you change the mass, then the system again becomes chaotic. So it's already a very interesting system. You can study the behavior transition from integrability to chaos by changing the mass. So we analyzed in detail, again, this system, and the result is the same. So it is basically a copy of what we have found for the hard point gas, in the sense that this is the equal mass case. It is ballistic energy transport. But if you increase the mass, if you increase slightly, first it go to this, and then it go to tend to a constant. This constant agree with Green Cube computation we have done also in this case. But this is the situation. So again, so this situation in which you deviate from integrability is what you, in these 2 examples, it's is the same. So it's something which we do not understand now, because you know, this problem, what we understand about thermal transport, as was said before, is based on, well, on numerical, theoretical consideration, which are few and difficult to obtain, and is mainly based on numerical simulation. Numerical simulation are done or via non-equilibrium simulation or via equilibrium simulation. And usually, when these 2 different kinds of simulation both indicate the existence of Fourier law, and not only, but they give the same numerical value of the coefficient, then people say, okay, this is, it means that there is Fourier law with this coefficient. But what I've shown here is show that it's not true. It may be an effect of finite size, and situation are a bit more complicated. So what we do not understand here, first, is that we have no indication about the critical value of the length after which conductivity become anomalous. From numerical analysis, this critical value seems to diverge as we approach the interval limit. And this is, to us at least, is quite surprising, because why it is natural to expect an initial ballistic behavior, because we are close to the interval case, for larger and larger system size, one approaches the interval limit, it is not clear why this value of k appears to saturate to a constant value, looks like to indicate the Fourier law, and why this Fourier-like behavior may persist in increasing wide range of the system before entering the anomalous regime. So basically what we don't understand is what is happening here. So it is clear that this must follow this. But why at some point it entered this constant regime, and this stay for a longer and longer time as I approach the interval case, and why after a longer and longer time it should turn on to the anomalous diffusion. So this is what we observe. I just tell you this because it's something maybe one shouldn't understand theoretically, but also tells you that you should take with some care numerical simulation. Also theoretical results are not, should be taken with some care, but anyway, the problem is difficult. So now, so this is the first contribution I wanted to make. The second one concerns a similar model to this. It's just a modification, but which show very interesting result. Namely, is a result of, it shows self-organization and non-equilibrium phase transition. You know that this famous self-organization takes place, like, for example, in Rayleigh-Bernard convention, in which you have a fluid layer which is heated from below, and then if the temperature difference is small, then you just have normal conduction, everything is smooth. But if you increase the temperature difference, then the chaotic microscopic motion of the system suddenly becomes macroscopically very ordered, and the system self-organizes in a pattern of cells, and the heat conduction dramatically increases. So this shows that the system can organize itself and adapt to the reaction of the strong thermal driving. This is known to take place in two dimension, in three dimension, but there is no idea that this effect can take place in one-dimensional system. There are some model, artificial model, I mean, there are OP models in which particle can hop from one side to another with some prescribed dynamics, but there is no real dynamical system in which you can show that there is a kind of non-equilibrium phase transition. So I want to discuss this. And what we do to show this, we took, it is a modification of what I said before, but also it is a modification of well-known Lieb-Linegar model in the sense that this is a classical version of this model. So the model is the following. It's very simple. Well, the particle, it is just an Hamiltonian system in which, so we have, first I consider one-dimensional system of M particle, and the size of the particle is R. So it is one dimension, and the dimension of the particle is R. They are in one-dimensional box, total size L, and this is the potential. So the potential is equal H if X is less than L and zero otherwise, okay? So it is a finite potential, H is the height of the potential, and it exists only for X less than R and otherwise is zero. So what we do is to take, we take two masses, M1 and M2, and for simplicity of numerical computation, we consider the case R going to zero. It is not crucial, but it just makes computation simple. So what does it mean? What is the motion? It means the following, that depending on the energy of the particle, namely, if the energy of the two particles in the frame center of mass of the two particles is larger than the barrier H, then the particle, they go through each other. If the energy is less, then they collide and they reflect it elastically. So this H determine and the energy determine whether the particle pass through each other or they're reflected back. Okay? So there are two limits, clear limit, obviously. One limit is when H go to zero, is zero, sorry. When H is zero, it means that there's nothing and the particle, they just move freely without any, no, they just pass through each other freely. And when H is infinite, it corresponds to the system I said before. It is just the hard point gas. So particles collide and reflect back. So in these two limits, we know what we expect from the point of view of thermal conductivity. In this case, H equals zero, we expect ballistic behavior, K proportional to L, to increase linearly with N. In this case, is what I said before, we expect anomalous diffusion and with coefficient increasing with N with the power 1/3. So these are the two limit situations, but the interesting point is to see what happens for any finite H. Okay, so to do this, we set up our system, as I said before, so we take heat baths at temperature left and right, so T plus delta, T minus delta, so delta is the temperature gradient. Now, in our system, the conductivity can be shown that has some scaling behavior, trivial. So basically, what we need to do is to study K as a function of temperature gradient and height of the barrier H. These are two relevant parameters we can change. Yeah. So it's delta and H. First, so we choose, for example, temperature equal 5, and initially we take a half particle with mass m1 equal 1, half particle with mass m2 equal 2. Okay? We fix L equal N, so there is one particle per so L is the same dimension. And so first, we check that the result do not depend on all these quantities. First, they do not depend on the particular temperature T, qualitatively. They do not depend on the mass value 1 or 2 or any other. They do not depend on this. They do not depend on initial condition. And especially, they do not depend on initial mass distribution. So you can never start initially with any mass distribution. The result will not qualitatively depend on this. So, but they depend on H and on delta. Okay, so this is the result which I leave you to consider. This is the result. It's done for H equal 10. So I choose one value of H. Then we will see that we can take any other value of H, but it will be the same. So this is typical. So let's take one H which is non-zero, not infinite. Because when H is zero, you get, here I plot the conductivity as a function of the sample size. So when H is zero, this is the ballistic, and again, this is this dotted line, and this is a result of numerical simulation for different delta t. When h is infinite, you get this, it is expected, n to power 0.3, and this is the curve, and these are result, the cross on the circle, a result for different delta t. So here, linear response theory, we can check is valid. You can change a delta t by something, well, not very big, but you get exactly the same result. Okay? So the result you get, they are not dependent on delta t as you change delta t inside some value. But if you take instead, so these are just for reference. But now let us look what happened for h equal 10, which are all the other curves. And so what has happened starting from delta 0 to delta 2, this is what you see. See, this dependence on n strongly depend on delta. So it's clear here there is no linear response theory because the result strongly depend on delta. And there is a value, this red star, which we call critical value, below and above, which discriminate between two completely different behavior of the conductivity as a dependence on n. Why? Let me see why. First, why this we consider as a critical value? First, the conductivity is a function of the system size on delta, very sensitive in the neighborhood of delta critical. You see, here, it ranges from 0.2 to 2, but here, these two different behavior, they just difference 0.01. It is from 0.74 to 0.76. It's a very little change in delta t make this difference in behavior. And second, it is most important, is that the structure of the system at the stationary state is qualitatively different below and above delta critical. Yes?
Maybe I missed something in the early beginning. The Fourier law is supposed to work in linear response. Or does it?
Yeah. No, well, yeah.
Delta should be small.
Delta should be small, yeah. For linear response should be small, yes. Oh yes, but you see, if you look here it doesn't matter if you change delta. Well, obviously you cannot make very large, but here you can take delta changing some reasonable value, you get the same result here and here. When you have this response, delta t must be small. But I mean, the system is larger and larger. So. What I'm saying here is that what happened is that the behavior of the structure of the system changed. You see, in which sense? In the following sense. Suppose we put ourselves above the critical value, delta 0.9. What happens is that the heavy particle tend, you know, because the particle they cross, sometimes they cross, sometimes they are reflected. But in this process, if you are above, it happens that heavy particles tend to go to the cold bath, and light particles tend to go to the heavy particles tend to go to the hot bath, and light particles tend to go to the cold bath. So there is basically the particle here become mass two, here mass one, and there is a transition layer in which the particles are mixed from one to two. And the point is that this transition layer has some width, and this width does not increase with the system size. So if I plot on the variable x divided n, as I increase n, this curve becomes more and more steep. It becomes just a kind of step, yeah, as I increase n, because the width in x doesn't change with n. So you see, this explains also why the behavior of conductivity tends to increase with n, because if you increase the system size, nothing happens. You just increase the length of the segment and the length of the segment, but the resistance is only given by what is happening in the middle. And this is why the motion become k become proportional to n. And the same is the temperature gradient. Also, the temperature gradient, as you increase n, tend to become this step function. So here, the temperature constant, here is constant. It's constant, why? Because the mass are the same. Here, all the particles in mass 2 come here, so mass 1 come here. So the system rearrange, like if you want in this Reni Bernard convention system. So this is what is happening, and this is why, above the delta critical, the system becomes, conductivity becomes ballistic. But the situation is different if you go below delta critical. If you lower delta critical instead, you have, instead of this sandwich structure we had before, here we have almost perfect scaling. And if you increase n, this curve all are on the same. Yeah. Also, this mass is not 2, it is below. This still there is a difference, some reordering. As you decrease delta k, this becomes more and more flat, it becomes more uniform, yeah, as you expect. So for delta less than this, this is what is happening. Then if you instead, if you go to exactly this value, then both the sandwich structure disappear, also the scaling disappear, and what you have, this is the temperature, which is the same scaling for delta less than delta critical. But if I go to delta critical, so both this structure before they disappear, and this I tend to get this structure with the blue curve as I increase n. Here, notice still the average mass here still tends to 2 in this limiting value. But this is also interesting because, and also the temperature does the same. But it is interesting because it is also interesting to see how the convergence of the average particle mass, for example, here to the left end, how it converges to 2. So here I plot the 2, the mass to the left, minus the average mass near the left end, for example. So if I am above delta critical, this goes like n to the minus 1.5. If I am above delta critical, if I am below delta critical, this becomes a constant, so it doesn't converge to 2, even if I increase n, so it remains different. And if I am at delta critical, this approach to the value 2 as 1 over n. Yeah? So this, all this consideration lead us to think that this, we are in presence of a kind of phase transition because the system reorganized and we have completely different behavior. Obviously, we don't have, these are numerical results. I already say, I am the first to say that one should be very careful, but in this case, it seems to me that we have strong indication of such a transition. And finally here, what they plot is dependence on H. So we took, for example, H equal 10, which is here. Now, if you decrease H, you just change delta critical, but the qualitative result do not change. Well, it may be, at first sight, it may be counterintuitive. Why, when you increase the barrier, in the sense you go to the hard point, air gas limit, you have delta critical even decrease. You go, delta critical go to 0. Yeah, this looks quite maybe not intuitive, but what is happening is the following, that if you take a very large 8, not infinite, if it is infinite, they just reflect. But if it is very large, but finite, what is happening is that the light and the heavy particle, it is very difficult for them to overcome each other because the barrier is high. But the probability of overcoming is larger for the light particle to go to the right than vice versa. So it takes a long time, but it happens. Instead, if you go with delta critical going to zero, this process of interchange obviously is much faster because the barrier is low, but it tends to be symmetric. You see? So this is why this, at first sight, is strange, but one can understand. Also depend on relaxation time. But obviously, we cannot make experiment for very small age or for very large age, but for this is what we observe. So the conclusion of this is that non-equilibrium phase transition can take place in one-dimensional Hamiltonian system, according to this. And the system, even one dimension, can adjust its structure to respond to external driving. So this is what we observe. So this is the second point I want to mention, which is connected to this, to time, momentum conserving system, and to is the second problem. Then the last question I want to discuss is about rectification. This is a different subject. Is about thermal diode. So, what is this? Well, it was said by Stefano before that if you take a nonlinear system, here we have the on-site potential, of external potential. So there is no momentum conservation, it's nonlinear. This is the nonlinear potential. Nonlinearity is given by this alpha. And if you take this homogeneous, the same d and alpha constant on the lattice size, then the system is nonlinear, it is a bit chaos, and you expect Fourier law. And indeed, you get Fourier law. Okay, so this is what you expect, and if you do experiment here, you find there is Fourier law. Now, how to build a thermal diode? If you want to build a diode, you need to break symmetry. So together with the nonlinearity, you need also to distinguish between left and right. So there are different ways to do this. More or less efficient. This is the first possibility we have pointed out 15 years ago, in the sense that one possibility here is just to divide the system in three parts, and to have the first part and last part with the potential alpha small, which is close to harmonic, and the middle part instead to be strongly anharmonic. So we introduce a symmetry here, D3 and D2, and so in this case, this can become a rectifier, and the argument is simple. It is because the conduction band to the left and to the right, here the left and the right are almost harmonic, so the position of the band do not depend on the temperature. In the middle, it is strongly anharmonic, so the position of the band depends on the energy, on the temperature, whether cold is to the left or to the right. So, for example, if you put hot butt to the left, the position of internal band here will be here. You get this situation. So we have discontinuity at the interface. But if you put cold to the left and hot to the right, you get this situation. And there you expect to have larger thermal conductivity. So these are expectations. Then you can go to make non-equilibrium numerical simulation. And you indeed, well, you find not so perfect, but you find that if you put hot to the left, you have a jump here and here. Instead, if you put hot to the right, you have more smooth situation here. So these are internal temperature profile, which indicate that in this case, you expect that the heat current to be less. Indeed, when the high temperature is on the right side, this is the heat current, is 0.1 × 10⁻³. If you invert, you get less current. There is a factor 2. So in this case, you have bad energy transfer, so you have. So this is one way to get thermal rectification. So this was the first way we have shown. Obviously, there are many ways. After this, there were many theoretical papers, not experimental, unfortunately, only few experimental result. Many theoretical papers, but still the situation is not satisfactory. This I want to discuss a little bit because basically most recurrent proposals are based on coupling of two or three segments with different anharmonic potential. And so they are difficult to be experimentally implemented. The rectification power is small sometimes, and moreover, which is very bad, before I have not discussed, but it can happen, typically happen, that the rectification factor goes to zero as you increase the system size. So you see, this is not so nice situation, and what we can say is that our ability to manipulate the heat current after many years of the first proposal of thermal diodes remain negligible due to the lacking of efficient and feasible diode. So this is something which some problem that one should try to solve. And so I have a couple of suggestions for this, which I would like to discuss. Actually one suggestion recent, but we started from this idea that one way to get the rectification, a different way, is to use graded material, so material in which the mass is non-homogeneous. And this can be improved by adding long-range interaction. Can be strongly improved. So the idea is to take a system in which there is increasing mass. This is just a model. And also we introduce long-range interaction. So this is a Hamiltonian. There is on-site nonlinear potential. And then there is an interaction here with this parameter lambda. So if you put the lambda equal 1, you have Coulomb potential, and then you just... So then you can study how the rectification... Okay, so this with the usual non-equilibrium simulation, you can wonder how rectification will depend, will change, increase or not, when you change the mass gradient or when you change this lambda, which gives you the range of the potential. Okay? So now I can show some of the result, but showing that you strongly increase when you increase the mass gradient and when the potential is long range, which is expected somehow. So first, you see that this lambda, you see that this rectification basically reaches a maximum when lambda is close to 1. As expected, it becomes long-range interaction. Rectification, by the way, is defined by J, the difference of the two current divided the current itself. So this is what is called rectification factor. It is 2,000. So it's very large rectification. Here is show how rectification depends on the mass gradient. If you decrease, since one mass, the end mass is fixed, if you decrease the first mass, then you increase the mass gradient, you see the rectification increase, you see how it depends. But you see, in the same time, this is with long-range interaction. If you take only this, this means nearest neighbor. It also increases, but very little. So you see the combined effect of mass gradient and long-range interaction. Here it tells how it increases. Obviously, this is trivial. The rectification increases with the thermal gradient. This is expected, so nothing strange here. This is it shows that it doesn't decrease rectification when you increase the system size. So this is a way to obtain rectification. So rectification does not vanish when you increase n. Actually, here it increases. But if instead you have only nearest neighbor, that actually tend to decrease when you increase the system size. And okay, so this is a. So the message here is that one way to get rectification is to have this mass gradient and to have long range interaction. But as far as I know, it is difficult experimentally to realize this system with long-range interaction. I know there is some proposal, but probably it's difficult. So we recently, now we are thinking now, what I show now is what we are thinking now, to a system in which we hope it will be more near to experiments, and we would like this to do. So basically what we do is the following. The idea is the following. We take one nonlinear system, so we take one-dimensional system, made in such a way, we take one nonlinear system with some constant mass here. Then we take the same nonlinear system but with a different mass, and in between we put an harmonic chain, an harmonic connection. And see what happens. So this is the model we take. So you see, there is a chain of particles here. In our numerical experiment, we take 10 particles, but it doesn't matter. Which has this Hamiltonian. We take a quartic Hamiltonian. It is called the phi 4 model. I don't know if you are going to discuss this, but so we take such a lattice here. We take a similar lattice to the right, the same, but with a larger mass. So here we take, for example, mass equal 10. Here we take mass equal 1. And in between, we put an harmonic chain. So we have these two nonlinear systems with an harmonic chain in between. And this system seems to be very good for rectification. I don't know. I think this could be more close to experiment. I hope so. And indeed, what happens here is the following. You see, so this is the internal temperature gradient. As you see, when it changes, depending on the cold bath is to the left or to the right. So this, but there is this strong piece of constant temperature because there is harmonic chain in the middle. And if instead of the harmonic chain, you put the same potential with the different masses. By the way, in the central chain, we take a mass which is an average between the left and the right masses. So if you take the same potential, quartic potential, instead you have the usual gradient here inside. This, the temperature profile inside is different. But now if you go to compute the rectification factor, you see that strongly depend on this. So if in the middle you put just this, you take this nonlinear potential, you see that the rectification factor decrease as you increase the system size. So from 100 to 1,000, it decreases. But if in the middle you put this ballistic channel, then it is constant. So rectification here doesn't change with the system size, so it could be a good candidate to practically make the rectifier. Well, you may ask what is happening here? Why there is such a strong rectification? So we are working on this. One thing you can look is, for example, at the power spectrum of particle to the left and to the right. For example, here, when you put the high temperature on the left hand, where there are light particles, what is here, this is the power spectrum of a particle to the left, where the temperature is higher. This is the power spectrum of the particle to the right. You see, the two spectrums do not overlap. So you expect here the current to be smaller. If instead you invert the two bath, you see the two spectrum defined as before, there is begin to overlap, and this explains why the current in this situation is larger than before. Well, you may ask about the stability of such a thing, because you say, well, I put two nonlinear, in the middle I put a harmonic one. Suppose instead of harmonic is not so, is slightly anharmonic, then this is what is found here. Here, different curves refer to different harmonicity. Here you put in the middle the FPU beta model described before. When beta go to zero, you go to the harmonic situation. So you see here for beta small, you are close to the harmonic case. Obviously, if you increase beta, you go to the standard phi 4 model, then again, rectification decrease with the system size. But it is quite stable. I mean, if it is not perfectly harmonic, still you get very good rectification. Here it shows how it depends on the mass of the central chain. As I said, the first one is mass 1, the other one is mass 10. So here is the mass of the central chain. So it reaches a maximum as it is in the middle, basically. It is about 4 or 5. So you get this maximum value. Another interesting point is that instead of the mass, so you can change, also the system works, if instead of the mass you change the strength on the outside potential. You take the same mass, but strength change the strength on the outside potential. Even in this case, this is the equal mass case. By changing the strength of the on-site potential, you also get the ratification, which goes to 200, which is not bad. But if together of this, you put also the mass difference, the unequal the mass graded system, then instead of 200, you go to 5,000. So you see, this is some model in which you have a strong ratification factor, and I hope that this model I want to discuss with some experimenters whether it is possible to implement, because this, I think, is the most important problem. There are a lot of theoretical work, but basically there are no experiments. And the experiment, and this is my last transparency, which is most famous, is this one, which was done 10 years ago on this nanotube. And what I want to say is that the ratification factor this is the most cited work. Everybody quote this experimental work, but the ratification only is basically 7%, which is almost nothing. It is at the border of the error. While in the transparency I showed before, the ratification factor of a few thousand. So even if experiments are not, they do not represent what I'm saying, I think that, it is very important to have some experiment in which the ratification factor is a bit higher than this, because this 7% is really close to the error. So this is what we are trying to do, and we are trying to insist to obtain this. I think I can stop here. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. We have 10 minutes for questions.
Yes?
What are you meaning by phase transition? What are the two phases?
The two phases is that in one case the conductivity goes diverge like n to some power, not clear numerically, but 0.3, 0.2, we don't know. In the other case, it is ballistic. And there is self-organization of the system. The transition is the system self-organizes. In the other case, not. So above this delta critical, all heavy particles go to the hot bath and light particles go to the hot bath. The system organizes in order to maximize the conductivity, basically. The other parameter is the strength, the height of the potential. There is the height of the potential and the thermal driving are the two parameters which matter.
Is there an end-waving argument for a very large mass ratio that explains the different behavior in that limit? What happens to the atoms in the large
mass? Well, I don't know. Well, we had some, but actually, well, the only thing we try to show is to look at the power spectrum when there is overlapping from one side to the other. This is the only thing we managed to look, and then we have some vague idea. But we have done some theoretical explanation of this, but which do not give understanding. There is some analysis of this model with different masses in which you show that in one case you expect larger conductivity than in the other. But this gives some theoretical explanation, but not understanding.
And back to the experimental rectifier.
Yeah.
How do you control the long-range interactions in the real system?
This is, well, first, this is why we are not satisfied with this, and why we went to this other model. But I discussed with some people, and some people made proposal to take different material, or I don't know, I forgot. But I discussed with Terasaki, for example, who made an experiment. He said that it can be done, but I don't think it is easy to do. I mean, we have an experimentalist here, so I don't know. I don't think it is easy to. Yeah, this is why we were not satisfied, because our aim would be to try to study some model which can be experimentally constructed. So, but I don't know. Stefano.
The H equal infinite limit is the usual hard point gas.
But there is no continuity. It's not the H infinite is not the limit for H going to infinite of a model. Well, because in that case, well, it cannot be. They cannot have a transition because the system remains. You cannot have self-organization of the system. Yes. They just go to separate, and then we have a constant here, constant here. So no matter you make larger and larger, nothing happens. You have ballistic. It's different, completely different. This is why we say in the hard point gas there is no phase transition, but there is always. This is why we say, we, also there we are not sure, but we believe that in the hard point gas there is no phase transition. It is just always a question to go to a larger and larger time. Maybe you will.
No,
you agree on that, okay, good.
Okay. Yeah.